I am pleased to welcome the Green Party's candidate for president, Dr. Jill Stein, and the Libertarian Party's candidate for president, former New Mexico Governor Gary Johnson. Tonight is the first of our three-part conversation. Part two will air tomorrow night right here on this program. Part three will be available for viewing exclusively online at our website starting tomorrow night at 11:30 p.m. Pacific time, immediately following the West Coast airing of this program. For now, though, let's get this conversation started. We will focus tomorrow night on foreign policy, tonight then domestic policy, and I'm pleased to have both Mr. Johnson and Dr. Stein with us. Thank you for agreeing to do this. We're glad to have you on the program.
Thank you.
And thank you both for agreeing to give 90-second responses to these questions. The first question, we'll start with you, Dr. Stein. In a presidential election year where the two major party candidates have both had favorability issues and trust issues, why has your campaign not picked up more ground? It seems that this is a tailor-made election for a third-party candidate to rise.
It absolutely is. And the American people are clamoring for other voices and other choices. These are the most disliked and untrusted candidates in our history. Unfortunately, we have a system that is very carefully firewalled in order to protect the political establishment so that real challengers like Governor Johnson and myself are basically excluded from coverage. We have to fight very hard in order to get on the ballot, and we are excluded from the debates. This is a case in point. Donald Trump got $4 billion worth of free primetime televised media. Hillary Clinton got $2 billion. We got virtually none. I think the governor got a little bit more than I did, but we were basically shut out compared to the other two candidates. So, you know, this is what the American people are demanding. This is what we should be giving them. And thank you to your show and to PBS for actually making this possible.
A few more seconds you still have left here. Let me just ask this question quickly then. Some have suggested that the Democrats need to rethink. I saw a piece in the Chicago Tribune the other day that Democrats ought to press her to step down now because of this new scandal regarding emails. Do you agree with that assessment by the Tribune or not?
You know, my feeling is that the FBI's reopening the case is very poorly timed and irresponsible. This should not be done 8-9 days before an election. I think the issues have already been there and are not new to Hillary Clinton's voters, but I think that there were already enough reasons on the table for people not to trust Hillary Clinton and for her not to be in the White House, and I would say the same of Donald Trump.
Governor Johnson, same question for you. In this election season, when the table seems set for a third-party candidate to rise, with both candidates being disliked and not trusted, why not more success from the Johnson campaign?
You know, I'm going to label this as success. Mm-hmm. I got to tell you, six major newspapers endorsing my campaign, the Chicago Tribune being one of the larger newspapers, kind of summarizing what they've said is they said, hey, you know what? These guys, Bill Weld and Gary Johnson, may not win, but two former Republican governors that served in heavily Democrat states, these guys made a difference. The things they're saying, fiscally responsible, smaller government, lower taxes, socially inclusive, talking about marriage equality, woman's right to choose, ending the war on drugs, military interventions. Look, let's stop with regime change. And that free markets are a good thing. They'll result in more U.S. jobs, not less U.S. jobs. They said, look at what these guys are saying. In 10 years, all candidates will be talking about the issues that they're talking about now. So vote on principle, Americans. Vote on principle. This is how you're going to change things. This is what we're doing. Like I say, these guys may not win, but we're going to take a principled stand here, and we think it'll make a difference.
In 15 seconds, same follow-up for Dr. Stein to you. Do you think that the Democrats ought to be pressing Secretary Clinton to step aside, to do anything different given this new scandal regarding these emails?
Well, I think it's just very, very significant that he would raise this with 11 days to go, having dropped it earlier. Clearly, there has to be something there, and if he weren't to raise it, he would be under worse criticism going forward than he is now. So I just think that starting on day one, I think Hillary Clinton is going to be engaged in impeachment process if, in fact, she is elected.
Let's move on now to the next question. Governor Johnson, this question goes to you first. You oppose the minimum wage, but can anyone really live on $7 an hour?
Well, it's a minimum wage. It's labeled a minimum wage. So Something I say tongue-in-cheek, and I do say this tongue-in-cheek, why not raise the minimum wage to $75 an hour? Well, I think everybody gets it immediately, and that is, well, gosh, how can we afford $75 an hour? Nobody can pay that. Well, how is it that government can assign a wage to begin with? I just think that the market should prevail. I think it results in less jobs for kids entering into the marketplace. And minimum wage, look, minimum wage is minimum wage. It's not livable wage. And for me, having been in the private sector my entire life, I had 1,000 employees growing a business from a one-person operation to 1,000 people. Minimum wage was never an issue because nobody got less than, no one got even paid the minimum wage. Show up on time, wear clean clothes, good work ethic. Hey, we're not talking about minimum wage. We're talking about a wage that you can live on.
You got 30 seconds left. If the minimum wage, if your argument is that the market ought to decide, that means that poor people have their fate at the hands of the market. Is that really what you want us to accept?
Well, what I want people to understand is that we're restricting jobs, that the more you raise the minimum wage, the more and more automation occurs. I mean, you force the marketplace into automation. Do you know what's going to be one of the biggest disruptors here very shortly is the fact that the number one occupation in the United States is driver. And because we're going to have automated driving, trucks, taxis, I will tell you, this is going to be a gigantic disruptor moving forward. And fast food, that is also going to be subject to automation in a really big way. So these are issues.
Let me cut in with a slightly different question, still on the same topic for you, Dr. Stein. You call for raising the minimum wage, unlike Governor Johnson, but there are those who think that $15 an hour isn't even enough, that it hasn't kept up with the rate of inflation. How do you respond to that?
I think they're right, and I see $15 an hour only as a beginning, but it's an essential beginning. And we know that actually when we are priming the pump of the economy by putting more dollars into the hands of consumers, we actually grow jobs. So it's a myth that decent wages depress the economy or suppress jobs. They're actually very good for the economy. And we have serious problems in our economy right now where basically 75% of our wealth is concentrated into the hands of just 10%, the upper 10%. And the lower 50% has 1% of the wealth. This is not sustainable. 43 million people are in poverty, and it's something like 13%, but it's twice as many African Americans. We cannot have an economy that only works for the very wealthy and the very few. This is an economy in free fall. This is a stagnating economy. We need our economy to actually reflect our values and to ensure that it's working for everyone, not an economy that puts profit over people. My campaign is calling for a different kind of economy and a different society that puts people over profit.
This question goes to you, Dr. Stein. You have argued that the U.S. should peg its gun control policies to other countries like Norway and Australia who established gun buyback programs. Is that really the meat of your argument about gun control and gun rights and a gun buyback program? Is that really it?
No, okay. By no means. No, I mean, that's actually just something we note in passing, that other countries have done buybacks. I don't think that will work for us. Right now, we are a very divided and fearful society in which racism abounds and bias, prejudice, and fear abound. So we actually call for the improvements that the American people are calling for. We're not talking about a radical departure. We're calling for ensuring that the gun show loophole closes, that there are background checks, and that we get automatic weapons, basically military scale weapons, off the streets, and that we get rid of this impunity to gun manufacturers and distributors so that they are held accountable for the misuse of their weapons and for putting those weapons into the wrong people's hands. But we also call for a Truth and Reconciliation Commission so we can come to terms with the abundant racism and fear that pervades our society. If we're going to actually move forward and become a less violent society, it's not just a matter of getting rid of the irresponsible guns out there and the guns that are in danger dangerous hands, but actually addressing the issues of fear, bias, and racism through a Truth and Reconciliation Commission and a deep discussion about race at our community levels.
Governor Johnson, this question is for you. You, conversely, oppose any restrictions on firearms. I guess the question is, should we bear arms in schools or churches? Should people on the no-fly list be allowed to have guns?
Well, first of all, I support the Second Amendment. Having said that, should we be open to a discussion and a debate on how we keep guns out of the hands of the mentally ill? Absolutely. Should we be open to a debate and a discussion on how we keep guns out of the hands of would-be terrorists? Absolutely. As President of the United States, I would love to know what transpired between the FBI and the shooter in Orlando. I'd love to know what transpired between the FBI and the recent bomber in New York. Clearly, the system is working up to a certain point, but is it an issue of more resources that it could be more effective moving forward? If that's the case, as President of the United States, I would allocate those resources. No automatic weapons are allowed in this country. Those were banned decades ago. And currently, semi-automatic weapons, the kind of which are now, many are labeled assault rifles, there are about 40 million rifles in that category. So if you're going to make those semi-automatic rifles illegal, you're going to make a new category, I think, of criminal in this country that otherwise would not be criminal.
Very quickly here, though, when you say we ought to be open to a debate and a discussion about whether persons on the no-fly list have weapons, why a debate or discussion as opposed to an emphatic no? No one on the no-fly list should have access to a weapon.
Well, because currently on the no-fly list are active members of Congress. For one thing, so one of the issues I believe is just an expedient way to address if you are on the no-fly list and shouldn't be there. Is there an expedient way that you can get off of that? And I believe that that's an issue of resource. But currently, it's a bit on the cumbersome side. And I'll just point out, current members of Congress currently on the no-fly list.
This question is for you, Governor Johnson. You would repeal the Affordable Care Act, but so many low-income Americans benefit, as you well know, from extension of Medicaid. How would your plan address the poor's lack of access to health care?
Well, first of all, I don't think it's realistic that we're going to repeal our health care. But when it comes to health care, what we need to do is to bring a free market approach to health care. And by the way, health care is as far removed from free market as it possibly can be. If we had a free market approach to health care, we would not have insurance to cover ourselves for ongoing medical need. We would have insurance to cover ourselves for catastrophic injury and illness, and we would pay as you go in a system that would be absolutely competitive and offer lower prices. So there's no advertised pricing, there's no advertised outcome. When you go to the doctor, you have no idea what it's going to cost. You can't shop the health care that you have. You could have health care savings accounts. I think that having health insurance to cover yourself for ongoing medical need is analogous to having grocery insurance. Imagine, and something we don't have, but imagine the grocery shopping experience if you had grocery insurance. Go to the grocery store, no prices on the counters whatsoever. When it comes to ground round or filet, I'm going to have to take filet every single time because I have grocery insurance. I just think that there are so many ways that the government could create real competition in the healthcare area, allowing us to buy prescriptions from Canada. How long would the high prices of prescriptions exist in this country if we were allowed to buy in Canada? They would last about a nanosecond.
Dr. Stein, this question is for you. Speaking of healthcare, you have denounced Big Pharma as corrupt and abusive. If my research is true, you have either held or hold stock investments in the pharmaceutical giant Merck. If that is true, tell me yes, and if so, why?
So I actually gave up, sold, divested from Merck. I will say that my husband still has some Merck. We have separate financial policies. Mm-hmm. I have divested from Merck, from GE, from DuPont. from the real bad actors out there, and am predominantly invested in index funds and mutual funds that are broadly distributed into an economy which is very problematic and which is dominated, again, by pharmaceuticals, by health insurance, by war profiteering, by fossil fuel industries. And I am interested in moving my money in order to support better investment. But, you know, I think it's really important that we fight for change regardless. So most investors actually are part of this reprehensible economy, and that should not stop us from fighting to change that economy, which is critical.
This question is for you, Dr. Stein. Your plan to lower the national debt is to end, as you call it, neoliberal austerity measures and to increase spending. For those who hear those two things as counterintuitive, maybe even counterproductive, mm-hmm. how do you respond?
Yeah, so it's widely understood now by many economists that in the presence of a recession or an economy that is struggling, that austerity is the worst thing that you can do, that it is counterproductive, that it prevents the economy from recovering. We know that, for example, from the experience in Europe with Greece, for example. We know that from U.S. experience prior to the Great Depression. Recently, the International Money Fund issued a report saying that austerity is exactly the wrong thing, that you need to invest in the economy. The Federal Reserve said the same thing. So we're calling for prudent investments to recreate a productive economy. What I'm calling for, a Green New Deal, is the antidote to NAFTA and to the Trans-Pacific Partnership and to these so-called trade agreements, which are basically crony capitalist trade agreements that send our jobs overseas and depress our wages here at home. Instead, we need to be creating these jobs here at home and growing our way out of this debt.
Governor Johnson, this question is for you. As a fiscal conservative, how do you explain that when you were elected governor of New Mexico, you inherited a debt of $1.8 billion but left office with a debt of $4.6 billion?
That is absolutely horse shit, is what that is. I have no idea where that came from. I actually saw that article, and I have no idea. There is absolutely no basis in fact for that. None.
All right. Enough said. Gary Johnson, we will go to this question, and this is for you. You oppose cap and trade because you've said so many times and yet acknowledge man-made climate change. So how do you propose that we fight global warming?
Well, I think the free market, if you use coal as an example, has basically bankrupted marginal coal at the moment. Right now, coal makes up about 36% of our electrical load. And right now, nobody's going to build a coal-fired plant because natural gas is much cheaper. So you can figure on coal being phased out. The coal that is currently marketable is the Wyoming coal, and there may be others in this country, but I think the free market has done that. I think you and I as consumers are demanding less carbon emission, and we're seeing that happen. Looking at cap and trade, I was open and would be open as president of the United States and having been governor of New Mexico, I'm open to any discussion that I think might make things better, cost less, work better. So looking at cap and trade, it was that pretense that I was looking at cap and trade that this might actually work. Well, apparently, this is my assessment and many others, is that it's just a bit too complex and that it actually wouldn't work.
Before I move on to Dr. Stein, since I got 20 seconds left here, since you called it horse, you know what, what do you recall the deficit was that you left New Mexico with?
Well, I left New Mexico with a $1 billion surplus, and when I took office, you could argue that there was a $1 billion surplus.
Okay. Dr. Stein, your platform has proposed to kick off a job-producing energy program based on clean, safe, and renewable energy. You referenced that earlier in this conversation, and you denounce reliance on coal. But coal is cheap, so how does your energy plan affect poor people?
Great. So, and let me say, it's not just coal, but it is fracking and natural gas as well. Mm-hmm. The science tells us that that is every bit as devastating. In fact, we know that natural gas, also called methane, is 80 times more powerful as carbon dioxide and the usual fossil fuel emissions of carbon dioxide. So it's not like natural gas represents the market taking care of this problem. Not whatsoever. It represents how the market gets stuck in putting profit over people and the planet. And let me tell you how this is good for people. The way this is good for people is that we create a nationally subsidized program to create these jobs in clean renewable energy, and that we ensure that the cost is affordable. Right now, we pay so much in health care costs related to fossil fuels that by moving to zero fossil fuels, we save so much money, it's actually enough to pay the costs of the green energy transformation. So when you balance out the savings in our healthcare and the savings in the military, where we no longer need these wars for oil that consume half of our discretionary budget and almost half of your income taxes, we save so much money through those two offsets, also by moving our subsidies, mm-hmm. tens of billions of dollars, into green energy subsidies, that we can ensure that this is a win, especially for poor people, because they are the first in line for these jobs, which are good wage, living wage jobs.
This question is for you, Dr. Stein. You want to increase affirmative action programs, yet recent Supreme Court decisions, as you know, have started to limit these programs. How do you respond?
Well, there are various ways that we can ensure that these programs are targeted to the areas of greatest need. So, as you know, unemployment rates are highest in the communities of color, mm-hmm. particularly in the African American community. And the way that this Green New Deal works, which is like the New Deal that got us out of the Great Depression, so it's not a hypothetical, it's not an abstraction, it's something we have done before and that we put money into. Those jobs are targeted first to the communities of greatest need, and whether we define that on the basis of communities of color or on the basis of the highest unemployment rates, those jobs will get to the communities of color that need them the most.
Governor Johnson, you are for the abolition of affirmative action. To some people, that might sound a bit, if not racist, racial. How would you respond to that kind of that criticism?
Well, I think that so many of these government programs had a place. And let's just argue for a second that affirmative action was positive. I just think it perhaps has outgrown its positive. I think this is an example of crony capitalism. Crony capitalism, when government picks winners and losers. I think affirmative action, for the most part, is gamed. And that those that know how to game it, game it. And I think we've grown beyond affirmative action.
Let me get this last question. I'm out of time. I want to get one more in, but I don't have enough time to give them both a fair chance to respond. A couple of things I wanted to get to tonight that we did not get to tonight. That is our program for tonight. We talked about
that.
That
was too quick.
I know.
I
told you it was going to go fast.
Anyway, very
that's
good.
Our show
very
tonight.
Good.
We talked, of course, about domestic policy. Tomorrow night, we will talk in the second part of our conversation, our forum, about foreign policy. Tonight is the second of our three-part conversation. Now let's get the conversation started. We will focus on foreign policy. Both candidates, once again, have agreed to limit their responses to 90 seconds. The first question is for both of you. For you first, Governor Johnson, are Julian Assange and Edward Snowden heroes or enemies of the state?
Based on what I know about Edward Snowden, and based on what I know is that the information that he made available, which he made available to major news outlets for them to release, because he was afraid if he did that, that he might put people in harm's way, or that people would get hurt as a result of that. To my knowledge, no one has been hurt, and based on that, I would pardon Edward Snowden. I would like to turn the satellites away from the United States. There is a process in this country, due process. Someone suspected of terrorism, go to a judge, get a warrant. But in my opinion, when the NSA through the FISA court, says we want to tap into 110 million Verizon users. That is not the country that we live in. WikiLeaks, Julian Assange, to my knowledge, what he is doing is releasing information, period. That's what he is doing. I do put Edward Snowden in the hero category. Assange, I think, has been very value-added in revealing information that we all had conjecture over. Hillary Clinton, as an example, saying one thing to Wall Street, saying another thing to Main Street.
Dr. Stein, same question for you.
In my view, they are both heroes because they both revealed acts being taken by our government in violation of our constitutional rights. The spying, the mass surveillance, and in the case of Julian Assange, the war crimes that were being committed in our name. And I think it has been invaluable to the American people to be informed about what actually has been going on in violation of our rights, in violation of due process, and in the case of Edward Snowden, corrective action, at least the beginnings of corrective action have been taken at the congressional level. We would be completely uninformed right now of the massive violation of our right to privacy. So I think they both deserve their freedom, they both deserve pardons, and they both deserve a hero's welcome.
Governor Johnson, again, this question for you. You support the Trans-Pacific Partnership, better known as TPP, yet you said you find it imperfect. In what ways? How would you change it?
Well, I think nothing is perfect, but if there is a takeaway that I've had serving as governor of New Mexico for two terms, the takeaway is to try and sign on to anything that makes things better. Are things perfect? No. Oftentimes, and in that context, I may have vetoed more legislation than the other 49 governors in the country combined. But based on my assessment, and by the way, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing this blindly. I have economics advisors. Jeff Myron is my economics advisor. The staff at Chapman University, the faculty at Chapman University. The consensus, the overwhelming consensus is that TPP is positive, that it would result in more U.S. jobs, that it would eliminate many of the tariffs that exist right now. Is anything perfect? No, but does this advance free trade? It does. And bottom line, free trade, more U.S. jobs, not less U.S. jobs. Crony capitalism, when government picks winners and losers, this advances the government making less of these. In other words, this gets government out of the equation. This advances genuine free trade. Free trade, the opposite of crony capitalism.
Dr. Stein, you have said that TPP fundamentally attacks American democracy and sovereignty. Your words, which existing trade deal do you support, if any?
So there are bilateral trade agreements that the U.S. has, for example, with most countries that are a part of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. There are trade deals within Latin America that are based on promoting fair trade, that are based on promoting a more just and fair economy. There are different models of trade deals. You know, I think with the Trans-Pacific Partnership, it's clear what we're getting. This is NAFTA on steroids. This is not a good thing. This is a very bad thing that sent at least a million jobs overseas, that closed about 60,000 factories, that depressed our wages, and perhaps most disturbing of all is this system of investor-state dispute resolution that creates a court that's not even a part of our own domestic courts. These are judges appointed by the World Bank that conduct their own tribunals that enable corporations to overrule our democratically established laws and regulations that protect our health, our jobs, our environment, even protecting our banking system from financial corruption, a healthcare system in which we can have bulk negotiations with pharmaceutical companies. All of that goes out the window with the Trans-Pacific Partnership. It's very important that we stop it.
this question goes to you first, Dr. Stein. You both oppose the drone wars, and you both oppose boots on the ground to fight ISIS in Syria and in Iraq. How do you propose then that we deal with ISIS or ISIL, if you prefer?
Great. So it's really important to look at the track record here, because the track record of more violence, of bombing, of sending in troops, has been a disaster. Every one of these interventions, starting with Iraq and Afghanistan and Libya, has been an utter disaster. Each terrorist group that we have tried to contain in this way is stronger today, has more territory. And with each turn of the cycle of violence, we have a more ferocious and vicious form of terrorism to deal with. Witness ISIS, which grew out of the chaos of Iraq and Libya. So I'm calling for a new kind of offensive in the Middle East, a peace offensive, which begins with a weapons embargo, because currently we are providing the majority of weapons that get into the hands of all parties to the conflict. We are calling for a weapons embargo and a freeze on the bank accounts of those countries, in particular our allies, who are continuing to fund terrorist enterprises around the world. Hillary Clinton herself identified the Saudis as still, long after 9/11, still the major funder of terrorist extremism around the world. So we can take a stand in the right direction, use our moral authority for an intervention that will actually work, instead of more of these catastrophes that are bankrupting us, taking more than half of our discretionary budget.
Governor Johnson, how do you fight ISIL?
Well, first of all, we should stop with supporting regime change. If we are attacked, we should attack back. We should have an invincible national defense. But I stress the word defense. And in my lifetime, I can't think of one single example where we have gone in to support regime change where it has turned out positive. We created a vacuum in Iraq when we invaded. We took out Saddam Hussein. We created a vacuum when we went in to support the oust of Assad in Syria. And if you take Aleppo as an example, you've got Assad on the west side of Aleppo. On the east side of Aleppo, you've got the Free Syrian Army, which we supported. And when we supported them, there was all this conjecture that the arms that we gave them would end up in the hands of the Islamists. They were fighting hand in hand with the Islamists to fight Assad. Well, that happened. And also, those arms ended up in the hands of ISIS, Raqqa, which arguably was created because of the void, the vacuum, because of our invasion of Iraq, and that Saddam's henchmen fled to Raqqa. We're supporting the Kurds against ISIS. The Kurds are sideways with our Turkish ally that aren't such a good ally anymore because of our invasion of Iraq. And before any of this started, we gave resources to Assad to fight the Islamists before any of this started.
Dr. Stein, I hear you. I hear you, and thank you for that response. Dr. Stein, just trying to watch our time. We're on to you now. What would a CIA look like under a Jill Stein administration?
It would be a professional organization which advises the president on what the realities are of the threats to the United States. And the CIA has had integrity in the past, and I think it could going forward, but we need to ensure that it is not enveloped by a military-industrial complex that is ruling the day and that is looking to beat the war drums. You know, it should be neutral. It was certainly politicized under Dick Cheney, who was generating intelligence that was extremely flawed, that helped drive us into the war in Iraq. We need intelligence that is reliable, that is not politicized, and that's going to a White House which has an even hand and which is not funded by the war profiteers, which are pouring money into both the Democratic and Republican parties. It also needs to be free of this revolving door in broader government, where people are moving from the defense industries and the defense contractors into the Department of Defense.
In 15 seconds, do you trust the intel that's coming out of CIA these days?
Not entirely.
All right.
So, for example, the intel, which is, I'm not sure if it's coming, I don't know who it's coming from, actually. And it seems to be Homeland Security and the NSA, which is talking about the Russians being the source of the hacking.
And you don't, buy that?
I don't buy it. Okay. I mean, where's the evidence?
Okay.
Why don't they show it to us? They're talking about motives and methods. That's all. That's not evidence.
Governor Johnson.
And that's very dangerous.
Governor Johnson, this question is for you. You oppose torture. You're clearly on the record about that. You oppose torture, yet you support Guantanamo. How do you square the two? How do you reconcile the two?
Well, by support Guantanamo, I am absolutely opposed to Guantanamo for all the reasons that we should be, and that would be torture and detention without being charged. But there does need to be a facility to house those prisoners that have no home. And by have no home, clearly they're guilty. And by the way, this could all be done via military tribunal when it comes to due process, something that is not currently taking place. But if we were to send many of these detainees at Guantanamo back to their home countries, they would end up getting killed if we did that. So a facility like this needs to exist. When Obama said, hey, I'm going to close Guantanamo, well, what he should have said was, hey, I am close, which he did. He said he closed Guantanamo to torture and to detainment. The detainment without being charged still exists. But if we close Guantanamo, we're going to have to open up a similar facility somewhere else. So with one of my problems with Obama is transparency. Just tell us why you didn't close Guantanamo, given the fact that you said you were. And the reason that he's not closing Guantanamo are those things that I'm raising right now, those same reasons.
Well, while you're reconciling, let me ask you another question about how you reconcile something else. You oppose financial aid to Israel, as you do to all countries, in fairness to you, although you favor the continuation of what you call strategic aid to Israel. Is that splitting hairs? How do you reconcile those two statements?
Well, strategic aid, they are a military, they are an ally. And having been to Israel, having visited with Benjamin Netanyahu, Shimon Peres, Ariel Sharon, the big takeaway that I had having visited Israel is that they really don't need our assistance at all. They are best able to determine their own outcomes. And it's really a fallacy, or it's wrong on behalf of the United States to think that we can presume how to answer or to solve the problems that they do have.
Dr. Stein, you have proposed that the U.S. stop arming, using your words here, stop arming and funding governments committing war crimes, among them Israel. Do you believe then that the U.S. support of Israel makes us complicit in the war crimes that are being committed?
Yes, and that applies to Israel. That also applies to Saudi Arabia. And I call for an even-handed foreign policy across the board, where we are very clear, and with all due humility, because we ourselves have been, you know, leading the charge in war crimes and in human rights abuses, mm-hmm. but that as part of turning over a new leaf in our administration, we would inform respectfully our allies that we no longer intend to fund, in the case of Israel, $8 million a day for the Israeli army, which is committing flagrant human rights abuses, war crimes, occupation, home demolitions, assassinations, collective punishment, you name it, just human rights violations across the board. We cannot continue to sanction that, not in the case of Israel, nor in the case of Saudi Arabia. And we need to put our weight firmly on the side of a process that brings together the grassroots groups who are actually making progress themselves between the Israelis and the Palestinians. They have human rights groups themselves that are beginning in a very effective way to establish trust, to build confidence, to build a sense of community. That's what we need to be supporting. So it's not us imposing our solution on them, but we need to stop supporting a flagrant offense against human rights in the form of the current Israeli government.
This question is for you as well, Dr. Stein. You said that the Iranian deal is not viewed as a threat by most intelligence services, and that it should be used as a template to denuclearize the Middle East. My question is, who do you trust, either by name, in terms of leaders or countries, who do you trust in the Middle East to help implement this policy?
you know, I think it's a question of negotiations. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to sit down with not only with the Iranians, with the Israelis, with really Iraq, you know, with all of the countries of the Middle East to create a nuclear-free Middle East. You know, in the case of Iran, there was a, you know, a question about Iran having a nuclear program in the future, and that was disputed by many intelligence agencies. But this was a future threat at worst, whereas there are countries right now who are violating nuclear agreements. Israel has nuclear weapons, and they're not supposed to. Pakistan, India. There are many countries that have nuclear weapons. We need to sit down with the Russians in particular, because we have the bulk of nuclear weapons. And right now, we are investing $1 trillion in a new generation of nuclear weapons at a time when Mikhail Gorbachev, the former president of the Soviet Union, in his words, we are at the most dangerous nuclear weapons moment that we have ever been in history.
Since I got 20 seconds here, quick follow-up, since you mentioned Russia a couple times tonight, can you hit the reset button? Can you sit down with Russia after the accusation of what Putin has been alleged to do in this campaign?
Absolutely, yes. I mean, what Putin has been alleged to do is to have a hacked. We hack all the time. I mean, and the Russians, in fact, have been trying to get us to sit down and collaborate on a treaty against cyber warfare. So, you know, I think we can have principled negotiations with the Russians about nuclear weapons and about cyber warfare.
Governor Johnson, another compatibility question for you. You have said that Iran is not a military threat, and yet you oppose the Iran deal on the grounds that Iran is, your words, the number one financier of terror around the world, close quote. How are those two statements compatible?
Well, I was skeptical of the Iran deal because they were and arguably may be a major funder of terrorism in the world. Now, with regard to the number, $165 billion, that is a number, or that is money that needs to be monitored as to whether or not that does end up in the hands of terrorists. And as President of the United States, I'm pledging to honor all treaties and obligations. So given that the Iran deal has been signed, I'm going to line up on the optimistic side that this actually will prevail, that surveillance, that monitoring is in place, and that we will be able to see and monitor that they are not engaged in the development of nuclear weapons. So I, like I say, I'm going to be optimistic about this deal, and I'm going to support this deal as President of the United States. But coming into it pessimistically, I think that's probably a good, that would be my overall, that would be my overall outlook on military intervention is I'm a skeptic.
Well, as President of the United States, Governor Johnson, how would you deal with this? The government is accepting, as we know at this moment, very few Syrian refugees, that is, and yet we continue to preach to the world about human rights. How would you handle that situation as president?
I think we should increase Syrian taking in Syrian refugees, believing that there will be and that there is a very intense vetting process taking place. When the debate occurred the other night between Clinton and Trump and they started talking about safe zones, the first thing that came to my mind was about six different questions. I'm not receiving national security briefings, but I'm going to guess that in those national security briefings, they were talking about safe zones. Well, safe zones, what does that mean? Does that mean boots on the ground? That is going to mean U.S. troops on the ground. And is that then not going to become a sanctuary for the Islamists and open then to getting attacked and that U.S. troops will lose their lives? I think a much more viable strategy would be to increase those refugees allowed into this country, and we could also step up funding, and we are funding refugees in the surrounding countries. So Jordan being one of those, we could increase that funding to allow more refugees safe havens in adjacent countries.
Same question for you, Dr. Stein. How do you square our not taking in more refugees with this notion of advancing human rights around the world?
Yeah, they can't be squared at all. Right now, there are 65 million refugees around the world, which is tearing apart the Middle East and Europe and other places as well. And most of these refugees are being created by the wars that we have instigated largely. So we need to take responsibility for these refugees. We also need to stop these wars that continue to generate more. And that's where I think the weapons embargo and the freeze on the bank accounts of those countries who are continuing to fund terrorism, I think fundamentally you gotta stop what's generating this problem. But in the meantime, we have to accept our proportional responsibility. And we need to take a large portion of the Syrian refugees that we have played so large a part in creating.
If you both give me a 30-second answer to this question, I think I can squeeze it in before this program ends. Our time runs so fast around here. You both propose to drastically cut military spending. How do you do that and keep us safe, Governor Johnson?
Well, the BRAC Commission itself in the mid-90s said that 25% more U.S. bases could have been closed, but the political will has not existed to see that take place. So submitting a balanced budget to Congress, a 20% reduction in military spending will not compromise an invincible national defense.
So our bloated and dangerous military budget is not making us safer. It's making us less safe. So we need to cut back to where we were before 2001, because the military budget that we have right now is it's not helping us. It's consuming half of our discretionary budget. So we need to cut back. For example, this $1 trillion program and a new generation of nuclear weapons. That makes us less safe, not more safe. There are many ways that we can cut. And I just want to say, I hope we can do this again. I think this has been a really important debate. And in addition to the online debate, I hope Governor Johnson will consider doing more of these debates at a time when the American people are really clamoring for something other than these two candidates being rammed down their throats.
I take your cue. That does wrap night two of this debate here on television. But the third part of this debate can be seen at pbs.org / Tavis Smiley, an exclusive conversation for another 30 minutes or so with Governor Johnson and Dr. Stein as we continue talking about these important issues in this all-important election season. Welcome to the third and final part of our presidential forum. All of the questions for this exclusive online segment of our debate have come from social media. Both candidates have once again agreed to limit their answers to 90 seconds after we hear a 2-minute opening statement from each. And I'm glad that you both agreed to do that, because Pat W. Green from Twitter asked both candidates, what qualifies you to be president and why should I vote for you? I think that lends itself nicely to your opening statements. Dr. Stein, you have 2 minutes to begin.
So I'm a physician, I'm not a politician, and I'm in this to help heal our sick political system. I'm also in this as a mother on fire, because we have a generation that does not have a future, that does not have jobs, that can't get out of predatory student loan debt, and that has a climate which is collapsing on our watch. So we got a lot of work to do. My experience actually is as a citizen activist and as a physician activist, helping to build coalitions to actually change laws and regulations. I helped get money out of politics in Massachusetts. We passed public financing until the Democratic legislature repealed it. We passed it as a voter referendum. The Democrats repealed it. I helped clean up our coal plants and some of our polluting incinerators, helped create more racially just redistricting in Massachusetts. So that's my experience. Right now, we have a political system that people have had enough of. They are sick of the rigged economy, they are sick of this rigged political system, and they are sick of the two candidates that are being forced down our throats, the most disliked and untrusted in our history. So people are clamoring for something else. I'm the only candidate in the race that is not corrupted by money from lobbyists, but from corporate executives, and I do not have a super PAC. So I'm the one candidate that can actually stand up for what it is that the American people are clamoring for: an emergency jobs program, to solve the emergency of climate change, to bail out the students like we bailed out Wall Street, to make public higher education free, create health care as a human right, to create a welcoming path to citizenship and end to police violence, and to end these regime change wars which are making us less safe, not more safe, while they are devouring our budget and more than half of our discretionary dollars. So we can have a better world, but we need to be able to stand up and vote for it.
Dr. Stein of the Green Party, thank you. Governor Johnson of the Libertarian Party.
Well, there, I guess, Jill, there are a couple people that aren't corrupted by money. I don't owe anybody any money, and I've never taken a penny from politics. As an entrepreneur, as an athlete, I'd never been involved in politics prior to getting elected governor of New Mexico. Myself and my running mate, Bill Weld, we are two former Republican governors that got reelected in states that are heavily Democratic. Being small government, being about less taxes, you don't have to guess with regard to outcome. Neither of us were wallflowers. So we're all about smaller government. We're all about people being able to make choices in their own lives as long as those choices don't put other people in harm's way. So marriage equality, a woman's right to choose, legalizing marijuana, ending the war on drugs. As governor, I was more outspoken than any governor in the country regarding the war on drugs and the legalization of marijuana. Let's stop with our military interventions. Let's stop supporting regime change that in my lifetime has resulted in a less safe world, not a more safe world. Never has regime change in my lifetime turned out to be positive. And then free trade. Look, crony capitalism is alive and well. That's when government picks winners and losers. Free trade is the opposite of crony capitalism. Free trade will lead to more U.S. jobs, not less U.S. jobs.
Governor Johnson of the Libertarian Party, thank you for your opening statement. Now to these questions. First, Emily from Facebook asks, or writes, you both oppose mass incarceration and mass deportation. How would you concretely change our policies and overhaul the criminal justice system and Department of Homeland Security, Dr. Stein?
Great. So for starters, I would instruct the Drug Enforcement Agency to do something really radical, and that is to use science in determining what substances will be scheduled and which won't. The minute that is done, marijuana and hemp will come off of that list of substances. In addition, I will treat substance use as a health issue, not as a criminal issue. And I will seek to actually discharge from prison those who are wrongly incarcerated in the first place for using a substance which is less dangerous than alcohol and tobacco, that is marijuana. So I will have a fundamentally different system of drug enforcement. And I will end, in terms of immigration policy, I will end the current policies of detention, deportation, and night raids, which are a scandal and which are a violation of the human rights of people who have come here essentially as refugees. And above all, the most important thing that we can do to end this crisis and to stop this crisis of immigration is to stop causing it in the first place through NAFTA, which put a million farmers out of work south of the border, forcing them to flee here in order to support their families. I will stop the war on drugs, which is also creating the violence, forcing people to leave, and stop overturning and otherwise destabilizing democracies south of the border.
Governor Johnson, same question for you. How do you reform our criminal justice system, sir?
Well, as governor of New Mexico, I was the highest ranking official in the United States to call for the legalization of marijuana. So not just talking theory, but actually talking about what I did. Mm-hmm. We have the highest incarceration rate of any country in the world. 2.3 million people behind bars, and I refuse to believe that we are any less law-abiding in this country than any other country in the world. I believe its roots lie in the drug war. I believe when we legalize marijuana, we will then look at drugs first as a health issue rather than a criminal justice issue. I am slain by the fact that reading last week, the number one category of arrest in this country is still marijuana in the last 12 months. That is just horrible. That is just horrendous. Looking at immigration, we should make it as easy as possible for somebody that wants to come into this country and work to be able to get a work visa. And a work visa should entail a background check and a Social Security card that applicable taxes get paid. We should look at immigration as something positive. We are a country of immigrants. We should embrace immigration. By increasing immigration, we will become a robust economy, and that's according to the Wharton School of Business, as opposed to restricting immigration that would actually lead to less economic activity. Don't build a wall across the border. We will be on the wrong side of history with regard to that wall.
This question is for you, Governor Johnson, comes from Mary on Facebook. You oppose public funding of elections and support Citizens United. How do you think third parties can survive in a two-party system?
I don't think it's correct to categorize that I support Citizens United, but what I support is unlimited campaign contribution. That when you limit campaign contribution, essentially what you do is you empower incumbents. You empower those that are already in office to continue to hold their offices. But what we don't have right now is transparency. There's no transparency when it comes to super PACs. There should be 100% transparency. I have proposed forever that politicians wear NASCAR jackets, and that the logos that appear on the NASCAR jackets would be in size commensurate with the contributions made. Let's know who is contributing to your campaign. So unlimited campaign contribution, but 100% transparency. Limiting campaign contributions empowers incumbents. Limiting campaign contributions benefits Hillary Clinton. Mm.
Dr. Stein, this comes from Colton on Twitter, who asked, where would you get the money to bail out students, and will you have to raise taxes to make it possible?
Great. And let me just say, I don't think wearing a corporate logo makes it okay to buy out our government. Our government should not be up for auction in the first place. That's why I think we need public financing of campaigns. To bail out the students, let me just say, we came up with about $16 trillion when Wall Street needed it. If we can come up with the money to bail out the crooks who crashed the economy through their waste, fraud, and abuse, it's about time to come up with the money, a much smaller amount, in order to bail out the victims of that Wall Street fraud and abuse. So it's about $1.3 trillion. Here's one place we could get it. For example, instead of spending $1 trillion on a new generation of nuclear weapons, we could spend that $1 trillion bailing out a new generation of students and liberating them to be the real engine of our new economy. We could put a small tax on Wall Street. Why should one of the most profitable sectors of the economy be the only one that doesn't pay a sales tax? Us everyday people are paying a 5 or 10% sales tax in most states, but Wall Street is not paying a sales tax. By imposing a 0.2% tiny transaction tax, we can be generating what could be $300 or even $400 billion a year of revenue that could be used to bail out our students. It's not a question of how to do it. It's a question of putting real people who are accountable to everyday Americans, not those who are serving the cause of the banks and Wall Street, into our government.
Governor Johnson, this is John from, I assume, Facebook. This question came up in our the first night of our debate earlier this week, and so here it is again. The question, according to the Associated Press and the New York Times, you were unable to shrink the size of the state budget, which was larger when you left office than when you came in. How is this being a libertarian?
Well, I cut the growth, the historic growth of state government, in half, from about 11% to about 5%. When I left office, there were 1,200 fewer state employees than when I took office. And I will tell you, the big driver when it comes to state government is Medicaid, something that has to be reformed. It's not an option to say that we should not reform Medicaid, Medicare, Social Security. It's not an option, and yet neither of the major candidates are talking about doing that. So New Mexico, a state that's growing, one of the fastest growing states in the United States, I think that that was significant. And I've never claimed to cut the overall cost of state government, but did significantly reduce the rate of growth, something that was unprecedented. Never in the history of New Mexico had there been less state employees from one year to the next, much less seen that happen over an eight-year period.
From the first night of our debate until now, I went back to look at my own research about the issue that I raised on night one, about this deficit that ballooned under your leadership. You called it horse the first night we had this conversation. But there's so many media sources who are citing that factoid, and you were just really dismissive of it on night one. So all these news sources are wrong about that? I'm just asking.
Every one of them. Every one of them. It is absolute horseshit. Let me just say it again. Horseshit.
And you said it twice, but I heard you. all right. This question for you, Dr. Stein. I think it's coming, I want to pronounce it right, Galaxy Trekker, I believe, from Facebook. Dr. Stein, why is the practice of lobbying still legal in this country? Isn't it basically legal bribery? What will you do as president to ensure that lobbying is immediately and permanently outlawed? Can you do that, by the way? Outlaw lobbying?
I think Congress can pass laws mm-hmm. about money that changes hands and money that, I put it this way. We already regulate lobbying. Mm-hmm. Lobbyists have to register, and they are subject to various rules. So one could, for example, prohibit lobbyists from ginning up money for campaigns, which is really how they acquire their power. Mm-hmm. You know, lobbyists educate, and they write bills and position papers, et cetera. But, you know, lots of people can do that. Where the money really goes and where it really has an impact is when the lobbyist is raising campaign contributions and buying influence. So we can absolutely stop that influence peddling. There are all kinds of ways. We can have rules against pay-to-play so that if you are contributing to a political candidate, then you are not subject to contracting with them. That's one way to shut down pay-to-play. Another is to prohibit private money in political campaigns and say that they will all be publicly funded. It's not okay to be a billionaire yourself and self-fund, because then you get just one class of people who's running for campaigns. So we can clean up our system. It's not rocket science how to do this. We need people who are willing to stand up for everyday Americans and get the big money out and let the people back in.
Talking about tax reform, if you were to eliminate income tax and corporate tax and replace that with one federal consumption tax, I think you would issue pink slips to 80% of Washington lobbyists, because that's why they're there, to game the tax code.
This question is for both of you. It's a question about race and gender. I'll start with you, Dr. Stein. Stephanie A.H. from Facebook asks, in a country that is increasingly divided by fear, corruption, and systemic inequity, how will you as a white woman and you as a white man unite our country while addressing the need for real equity-centered reform?
Great. And I think this is a really critical question, because we are not in the age where, you know, we don't need affirmative action. We are not in the post-racial age. That having an African-American for president hasn't created a magic spell, and the problems of racism have not gone away. They're very much alive and well. In fact, the disparities, the economic disparities between African-Americans and the rest of society have only gotten bigger and more desperate. And that exists across many sectors of society, not just economic wealth or jobs. You know, it's unemployment, it's access to education. The disparities have only gotten bigger. So we need to solve this. I think we need solutions. We need direct and targeted solutions. And our Green New Deal begins to do that, ensuring that there are jobs and good quality jobs that are going particularly to the communities that most need them, and those are communities of color. But we also need to have a real conversation about race. We need to take the blinders off, because a lot of people are walking around with the blinders and they're living in this post-racial world because they're not a part of it. They need to see what's going on. We need to tell our stories. We need to bring our art and our music and have a real conversation about race so that we can get past this living legacy of the criminal institution of slavery that has, you know, that lives on today. We need to get past it and discover our common humanity. We are either going to sink on this ship together or we're going to sail together.
Governor Johnson, at this moment in our, this critical moment in our nation's history, as a white male, can you bring about equity-centered reform?
Well, black lives matter. Black lives matter because blacks are being shot at the rate of six times that if you're white. And a recognition by me, having been governor, that if you are of color and you are arrested on drug-related crime, that there's a four times more likelihood that you'll end up in prison as opposed to being white. So it is about awareness. I don't think it's ever been better to live in this country. I think we communicate with one another better. We get along with one another better. Our kids are smarter than ever. And the number one law enforcement tool that we have right now are our smartphones. I think we're going to deal with what has now become front and center, the recognition of this discrimination that in fact is happening. But I think we're going to come to recognize it. I think we're going to take steps that are positive. And I'm just back to the day and age that we live in, the internet, and that we will address this. And as Commander-in-Chief, as President of the United States, look, it starts with the Commander-in-Chief, the President, recognizing this.
I want to ask this question to both of you. It comes from Melinda Sargent from Facebook. What would you do with the EPA? Dr. Stein?
I think, like our other regulatory agencies, we need to stop the revolving door. We need to stop the campaign contributions that bias policy in various directions. I think the EPA needs to be charged with a much higher standard. So recently the EPA has been, tarnished by failing to take action, by the accusation that it did not move fast enough, for example, in Flint. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, that's not the only example of it. But we need to do, I think, more than even that. The EPA needs to defend public health and the environment. And right now, we are looking at a very serious climate crisis, which is barreling down on us, where the science is telling us as soon as 2050, we could see 10, 20, 30 feet of sea level rise. And it's Jim Hansen, who hasn't been wrong yet. He's one of the scientists who are, you know, clarifying how very serious this situation is. So I think the EPA really needs to step it up. And in order to protect our health, it's not simply a matter of reducing, coal plant emissions. I think we need to zero out carbon emissions entirely by 2030.
Governor Johnson, what'd you do to the EPA?
I think government has a fundamental responsibility to protect us against individuals, groups, corporations, foreign governments that would do us harm. I think pollution comes under the heading of doing us harm. And there are real polluters out there, and but for the EPA, they would be polluting. As governor of New Mexico, there was a major mining operation in northern New Mexico that had been metals contaminating a river in northern New Mexico. It had been going on for two decades. Nobody addressed it because of the political ramifications of the loss of jobs. When I was governor, I confronted them. You need to come to the table. You need to tell us how you're going to clean this up. I'm going to give you 30 days to do that. And if you don't come to the table in 30 days, I'm going to make you a federal Superfund site. And that but for federal EPA, perhaps they would still be polluting to this day. So I'm a believer in the EPA, that it does protect us against polluters that do, in fact, exist.
There are a couple of questions here. My time is running, just 4 minutes to go here. A number of questions about the Dakota pipeline. Let me just pick one that I think is best of the group that I have in front of me. Christine Tree Potter from Facebook asks, I would like to ask both candidates what their stance is on treaty rights that were guaranteed by the U.S. government to U.S. Native American tribes.
We need to support those treaty rights. We recognize those treaties. We need to live by those treaties. Those treaties would stop the Dakota Access Pipeline right now. Even without those treaties, as a matter of fact, the obligations under the UN Commission on Indigenous Rights would also say that, and US policy requires that indigenous people be consulted and provide informed consent before projects are undertaken that significantly impact them. Losing your water supply, destroying your ancestral burial grounds, contaminating the air, and devastating the climate. This is outrageous. This is a violation of treaty rights. It's a violation of indigenous human rights, and it is a violation of the protections that all of us need for our water and our climate.
Governor, are we trampling on the rights of Native Americans?
Well, I think one of the cornerstones of living in America are property rights. And as governor of New Mexico, not one instance over an eight-year period did I ever instigate eminent domain, the condemnation of property outside of the control of government for whatever reason, not once. It's my understanding that these treaties do exist and that they give the tribe oversight or decision-making over those lands. And I would not be supporting trampling of those rights.
One final question. I've received a number of these questions. This one particularly comes from Natalie Hall from Facebook, and I want to tweak it just a little bit because there have been so many questions about this. The question essentially is about the Supreme Court. I don't need to recite for you the situation that we are currently in. There's a vacancy on the U.S. Supreme Court. President Obama nominated someone. The Republicans said we're not going to take it up until a new president, until Gary Johnson or Jill Stein or Hillary or Donald, somebody's elected. We're not going to take this up. What say you about the drama, I just put it that way, around the Supreme Court? And what would you do differently, Governor Johnson first?
I prided myself on the appointments that I made to the court as governor of New Mexico. The appointments that I made to the court in New Mexico were vacancies that were created. But I think I really had a really favorable outlook by everyone, that I made really good choices. When it comes to the Supreme Court, I think we need to choose justices that are going to rule on the Constitution on the basis of original intent. The Constitution of the United States is a document that limits the power and scope of government. The first 10 amendments of the Constitution, Bill of Rights, look, it's about protecting the minority against the will of the majority. So I've floated a couple of names out there. One is Jonathan Turley. Another is Tom Campbell as prospective Supreme Court nominees. I think that President Obama did the right thing by making a nomination. I think it's wrong that the Republicans did not at least grant hearings on that nomination.
Dr. Stein?
Yeah, I would agree. There's, you know, this isn't the only drama being played out in Congress. You know, everything is gridlock and drama, basically. But yes, that Supreme Court nominee should have received, evaluation. My emphasis, if I had the honor of serving in the White House, would be to ensure that the openings in the Supreme Court are filled with people who respect and understand the need to protect our voting rights, our women's rights, indigenous rights, immigrant rights, and workers' rights, all rights that are very much in jeopardy and in the target hairs. And I would say I would try to get past the gridlock in Congress by being an organizer-in-chief in the White House, because the driver of our democracy is supposed to be we the people. So I would be very much about the task of informing and empowering voters to be weighing in with our elected officials to ensure not only that we are evaluating Supreme Court nominees, but to ensure that we are passing the agenda that the American people deserve for jobs, to end the climate crisis, to bail out students, to create a welcoming path to citizenship, and to end these outrageous and dangerous wars.
The time goes so quickly. We are at the point now of closing statements. Governor Johnson, your two-minute closing statement first, sir.
Well, in this election, does anybody believe that the polarization in Congress is going to get any better if Trump or Clinton is going to get elected, when their agenda is to kill one another? I don't think so. But I do think that there is an honorable choice to this, and that's the Libertarian nominees, Bill Weld, Gary Johnson, occupying a big six-lane highway down the middle. Fiscally conservative, socially inclusive, skeptical when it comes to regime change, military intervention. And I might also add that among active military personnel, I'm the overwhelming choice to be the next president of the United States. Add to that free market, that free market is the opposite of crony capitalism, will create more U.S. jobs, not less U.S. jobs. Imagine Bill Weld, Gary Johnson, president, vice president, hiring a nonpartisan administration, non-political, Democrats, Republicans, Libertarians, Greens, Independents, and calling out both sides to come to the middle to deal with issues that are facing this country. I think that third scenario actually has the opportunity of succeeding.
Must be heartening, Dr. Stein, to hear that he'll at least hire you if he wins, since you're one of the Greens. Anyway, closing statement, Dr. Jill Stein.
Yes, and I thank you very much, Tavis, for hosting this, and I thank you, Gary, for participating. And I hope Gary will agree to do some more debates, because I think the American people need to hear more about who their choices are. They are absolutely chomping at the bit for something else. This is a realignment election. We are looking at the Republican Party coming apart at the seams. We are looking at the leadership of the Republican Party moving into the Democratic Party, supporting Hillary Clinton. We're looking at a merger of one big happy corporate party in the form of the Demo Republican Party now under the leadership of Hillary Clinton. This is, you know, at the same time we've seen Democrats split. And we've seen the Gary Johnson campaign, many of these burners who are now burning green together with us Greens because we have basically the same agenda and more as Bernie's campaign. The American people really need a different way forward and are clamoring for it. Right now, in the most recent poll, I'm running at 5%, which is right exactly where we need to be to ensure that we have a true party of, by, and for the people coming out of this race and going into this next election. That is a party and candidates who do not accept money from CEOs of corporations, who do not accept money from lobbyists, and who do not have super PACs. And we are the only political party for whom that is true. This is what the American people are clamoring for. We have the opportunity to hit the ground running coming out of this race if we get to 5%. So I'd say don't throw your vote away voting for more of the corporate politics that has thrown you under the bus. Invest your vote in a real movement for change. Vote green. If we get to 5%, we have $10 million for the 2020 presidential race. We also have automatic ballot status in most races. We need real leadership in order to deal with whichever predator is in the White House, whether it is a Democrat in the form of Hillary Clinton or whether it is Donald Trump. These are candidates the American people do not want. We need to have a political party of opposition that is of, by, and for the people.
Let me thank Dr. Jill Stein of the Green Party and Governor Gary Johnson, former governor of New Mexico.
Let me thank you, Tavis.
Thank you both. I'm delighted to have had you both on for all three parts of this conversation. And most importantly, let me thank you for watching both nights on PBS and this online version, especially thank all those persons who sent in those questions through a variety of forms of social media. We got to as many as we could, and we thank you for submitting them. As I say all the time, thanks for watching, and until I see you next time, keep the faith.